I have been a Christian since I was about 8 years old. Okay, I remember, and then I remember when I was a young teenager, probably 12 or 13, I remember there was a revival that went through my little Pentecostal church in Hollis, Queens. And we were feeling, all the young people were feeling this thing happened inside of us. We know what it was at the time. I know looking back, it was a revival and the Spirit of God was running through. How many of you are old enough to remember the Jesus movement? Okay, so that's apparently what it was, but we didn't know what it was at the time, but we were getting infused by the Holy Spirit. I didn't even understand what was going on, but all I knew was that as the music went forth, as the preaching, now I'm 12, 13 years old, I'm raising my hands, I'm feeling something going on inside of me, I was getting saved, and it was an amazing thing, and so I've been saved for a long time. I've been going to church since I was about 6 years old every Sunday, okay? So knee-high to a duck, so I know church, I know our language, I know what we do in church. I know that in black churches, if you get up and you have to go to the bathroom, for some reason you put up one finger and you walk out like this. I don't know. I still don't know why. I'm north of 50, and I don't know why we do that. Okay? In white churches, they got to go to the bathroom. They get up and they walk out. I mean, it just makes sense, right? You got to go to the bathroom, you get up. But in the black church, we do. So I'm familiar with the different cultures of church and all of that stuff. Been saved a long time. Been preaching a long time. Rich, I understand church. I know in some churches they do that. In some churches they do this. In some churches they shout, they praise God. In some churches they do this. In some churches they have flags. Pastor Ed and I hate that. You know, the flag, you know, anyway. Okay. We do. We just don't understand the flags. But I know churches, they do it all. We've been in churches here in America, churches across the world. It's amazing. Different churches. Excuse me. Here's the one similarity. There are people who walk into church, get saved, with habits, with anger, with all sorts of stuff going on inside their soulish areas. And 25 years later, they got the same anger. They got the same soulish stuff going on inside. And I'm trying to understand, why is it? How is it that you can be a Christian for 20 years? And if you were a fearmonger before you, that sounds terrible, doesn't it? Fearmonger. Let's change that. If you were very fearful, you know, a fearful person, you become a Christian, 10 years in, you're still afraid? How is that possible? How is it possible that we can hear the messages every day and seemingly we don't grow in specific areas? Statistics say that 20% of the men in this room right now are dealing with sexual deviancy. We're dealing with pornography and stuff like that. 20%. Okay? So if there are 20 of us in here, how many of us are having that issue? 4, right? 20%, right? So it's amazing. And if I ask the question, how long have you been a believer? You might say 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. Yet the problems persist. And I have been asking this question for a long time. See, because for a long time, I said I got saved when I was around 8 years old, and I really started to experience a revival when I was 13. I didn't realize I had real mad anger problems till I got married. And I got married when I was 20. I really was, I was 20. So I've been married 10 years now, and But I got married when I was 20. My wife had a dickens of a time dealing with me with my anger. I didn't understand it. But Rich, I'd been saved for years. I'd heard scriptures on let not your anger go, let not the sun go down on your wrath. Yet I was still angry. I've seen people struggle with pornography in their marriages. They struggled with it before they got married. They're married. And they're still dealing with it? Christians. I'm not talking about the unsaved now. I'm talking about Christians dealing with issues year after year without apparent growth. And I say, enough. I say, we've got to figure out what the heck is going on so that we can fix it, so that we can get to this thing called spiritual maturity. How many of you want to mature? How many of you want to grow? How many want to get past this stuff? If you're like me, you want to get past it, amen? All right. So I want you to look at some things with me as we discuss this morning, and I believe it's going to be an eye-opener for you. Further, I believe that the Holy Spirit is here. We welcomed him, did we not? And the Holy Spirit is here. I believe that the Holy Spirit wants to open our eyes this morning. He wants to convince us. He does three things, right? He convinces the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Of sin, because we're sinners. Of righteousness, Jesus died, right? So that we might be righteous. And of judgment, letting us know, hey, if you don't change, something's coming that you're not gonna like, right? So the Holy Spirit's job is to convince you and me of what we hear from the Bible, what we hear preached and taught and sang and worshiped, what we hear, his job is to get inside and convince us of the truths of those things and then empower us to make a decision to change, all right? So my job today is simply to give you the word, hopefully clearly, hopefully in a way that you'll understand it, because here's the thing. Understanding is important because here, if you don't understand what you hear, even though you have a free will, you will not have the ability to engage that free will because you don't understand. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my time here. We're going to talk about this. And it is 11:30. And I really want to be done by 10 minutes to 12. My wife chuckles. Thank you. Here's the message title. It's in the form of a question. It is not a question that I want you to ask of others. It's a question that I am asking you to ask of yourself. The message is entitled, What Was I Thinking? What was I thinking? Or, if you're asking yourself, you can ask it this way. What were you thinking? What were you thinking? You'll see why I entitled it that in a moment. The powerful impact of our thoughts, that our thoughts have on behavior. I want you to look first with me to Proverbs 23, verse 7. Proverbs 23, verse 7. Proverbs, as you know, is a book of context and principles. So we're going to ignore the context today, and we're just going to look at the principle that this scripture seems to indicate. Proverbs 23 and 7. Now, I grew up on the King James Version of the Bible. I don't read the King James anymore. I read the ESV, and sometimes the NIV, and sometimes the Amplified. But oddly enough, I still think King James. The seventh verse. For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. In other words, what he thinks, he is. What a man thinks, he is. The context there, which is not germane to the message, is that that's a pretty bad guy. You want to watch that guy, okay? But that principle is true of all people. What we think internally is who we are. Turn quickly to Romans, the 12th chapter, second verse. Romans 12, verse 2, please. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Now let's unpack this for a moment, because you're going to see a very obvious truth here. First of all, that word renewing there is the Greek word that we have for renovation. How many contractors do we have in the house? How many people own homes who've had some work done in their house by contractors? You ever see a renovation job? You ever see a gut job? You ever see them take the walls out and put up new beams? When you renovate, you remove what you see and replace what is behind what you normally see so that what you see will be stable. Now, he says, number one, I want you to be renovated where? In the mind. Now, since the Bible was not written in English, you know that, right? The Old Testament was written primarily in Hebrew, some Aramaic. The New Testament was written in Aramaic and Greek. So if you're really going to understand what the Bible is saying, you kind of got to go to some of the key words and find out what they meant or what they're saying in the original language so we can figure out what the writer was saying to them, hence what he's saying to us, right? Now, the word mind there is the Greek word nous. Now follow me, because I want to explain to you what this word means and see if it starts making sense to you. Mind, the Greek word nous, denotes speaking generally the seat of reflective consciousness. Someone say reflective consciousness. Yeah, comprising the faculties of perception and understanding, and those of feeling, judging, and determining. That's Vine's Bible Dictionary's definition of it. But look at Strong's. The God-given capacity of each person to think, reason. The mind, mental capacity to exercise reflective thinking. Reflective consciousness, reflective thinking. What is a reflection? If I am looking into a mirror, what am I seeing? Myself, right? If your thoughts and my thoughts are reflective, then what that means is my thoughts are the things that I see since I'm looking in a reflection. My thoughts are the things I live by because it's what I see as I live. In other words, my thoughts compose my actions. In other words, if you want to change an action, you've got to change a thought, which is why Paul said, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed, changed, metamorphosized. That's the word there for transformed, met like a butterfly or had a caterpillar becomes a butterfly, right? Okay, that whole process there, that's the Greek idea for transform. Be transformed by the renewing of what you reflectively see all the time. Then and only then will you be able to determine, as the scripture says, the will of God. In other words, we learn from Proverbs that what I think is what I do. We learn from Romans that, holy cow, the only way I'm going to know the perfect will of God is by changing the way I think. If I don't change the way I think, then I will be conformed to this world. And the reason Paul says don't be conformed to this world is because he knows that naturally our thoughts lead us to the conforming and the thought process of this world. But as a Christian, we have to change. Here's what I believe. I believe that Christians can be saved. You got a saved heart, but a pagan mind. That's why you can remain the same for 25 years. Because as we hear the word, we never convert our thinking to the reality of the word. So it simply becomes mental assent. But it never becomes a change in the way we perceive in thinking like God. So we can hear the word. And that's why the scripture says, don't be hearers only. Be doers of the word. Now, we're going to go deeper in a moment, and I'm going to show you how this works, okay? So, change the way we think, we change the way we live. Here's the thing, though. You and I don't always know what our thoughts are. Some of them are subconscious. Some of them have been learned when we were knee-high to a duck. Bad experiences. And as a result, we are living out of those belief systems, faulty belief systems, without even realizing it because we've been doing it so long. And some of us are engaged in things and are doing things right now in our lives, and we're trying to stop. We can't because we don't understand that we are on autonomic. We are just moving. We are, in essence, trying to meet needs, deep-seated needs, needs that we should, that should be met, but only through Christ. What needs are those? Their significance and security. You and I all have a basic needs. We need security, and we need significance. Do you all remember, how many of you have ever studied psychology back in college? Okay. You guys ever hear of the cognitive behavioral theory? Or therapy? Okay. Let me give you Tim Clinton's, Dr. Tim Clinton. He wrote a book called Caring for People God's Way. Let me read to you what this is. At the core of this practice is the process of assessing, identifying, and renouncing faulty thinking, adopting instead the truths and insight of Scripture and right thinking. In other words, as we counsel people, one of the first things we want to do, if we're sitting down and talking to you, if you came to me for counseling, or my wife, or Pastor Ed, or something, first thing we want to know is how you're feeling. What's going on? How you feeling? Tell me what's happening. And then the next thing we want to do is we want to identify faulty thinking and get them in line with the Scripture. Because if we can do that, if we can convince you that what you have is based on how you believe, and change what you believe, then we can change the course of your life. That's what Jesus does for us. Do you remember when Jesus said this to the disciples? He says, now you are clean through the truth that I have just shared with you. What he was saying was, now you can operate in reality because of what I just shared with you. Because they got it. They got the message. He wants us to get the message. Now, how many of you have heard of Maslow's hierarchy of needs? Yeah, right? Say, You know, if you've any educational training, psychology, training in psychology. I remember I was first introduced to this when I first went to college right out of high school back in Queens. And I remember hearing this, and it's never really left me. And basically, this hierarchy of needs is Maslow's understanding of humans and what our basic needs are to where we, in essence, flourish freely, okay? Basically a place of self-actualization. But let me go through them. Your first basic need are your physical needs, food, clothing, and shelter. How many of you believe that? I mean, you got to have something to food. You got to have something to eat. You know what I mean? You got to have shelter. But how many of you know you can have food, shelter, and clothing, but not be in a safe environment? So the second one is safe environment. Right now, you have many of the people in Ecuador had food, shelter, and clothing. But when the earthquake hit, they were not in a safe environment. So although they had food, shelter, and clothing, because of the emergency of their immediate state of emergency, they were not safe. So the second thing you and I need, in addition to food, shelter, and clothing, we need to be in a safe environment. You don't want to be living in a war zone, do you? Outside your door, people are shooting and firing and stuff like that, which, by the way, is such a problem in the inner city. See, we think, when you pray for people in the inner city, pray that God will begin to meet their basic needs. Not only of food, shelter, and clothing, because some of them don't even have that. okay? But for some of them in their communities, there are gunfire going on right outside their doors, which is why people in those communities get shot by being innocent bystanders. When you pray for the inner city, understand these needs. You and I take them for granted because we have them. But for some people, they don't have food, shelter, and clothing. They don't have safe neighborhoods. You, I, need to be praying for them. Amen? Because how can the gospel get through in a neighborhood like that where people are questioning, how can I believe in a God when I'm not even safe in my own neighborhood? So we want to preach the gospel, throw the gospel at those folks, throw the gospel at those folks, but they're not in safe neighborhoods. Amen? Threw that in for free. Third, a sense of belongingness. In other words, you are loved. You are accepted by friends and family. You have this sense of intimacy. So yes, I have food, clothing, and shelter. I'm in a safe neighborhood. But how many of you know those things are cool? But if I don't belong to anybody, if I don't feel loved by anybody, if I don't feel like I matter, like I care, like people care about me, when I come home, people don't say, daddy's home. But your children run to you, daddy's home. Your wife says, baby's home. Your husband says, yo, homegirl's home. We're going to live now. It's all good. That's a sense of belonging. Those things are what God gave us. Those are natural, understandable needs. But there's a fourth one, and that is a sense of self-esteem. It's what I talk about a lot in terms of purpose and value. It's what the writers talk about, significance and security. So you got food, you're in a safe neighborhood, you have a sense of belonging, but yet you're insecure and you don't believe that you know what your purpose is, and you're kind of wandering around in life. You don't know which direction you're going in. You're working a job that you can't stand. You're doing what you got to do because you got to pay the bills, but you have no direction. Your purpose and destiny, you don't understand. I'm telling you, you're an accident waiting to happen. So you got food and clothing. You have security in your neighborhood. You have a sense of belongingness. You belong to a woman. You belong to a man. You belong to your kids. You belong to your parents. They love you. They like to see you. They don't even love you. They don't not only they love you, they actually like you. Okay? But now you're also walking in your purpose, in your destiny. You know who you are. And finally, you've self-actualized. Not only do you walk in your purpose, but you understand what you're doing. You understand what God has called you to do. Do you see the five needs? Here's the problem. If we try to achieve significance and security in ways outside of God's prescribed plan, we will end up with addictions. We will end up with issues in our psyche that we cannot fix. Because what we will have learned is that once I've reached, as Stephen Covey said, and I love how he said it, I've climbed the ladder of success, but I find that the ladder is leaning against the wrong wall. So I got all these things. I'm a Christian, been saved for 20 years, but I can't get loose of pornography. I'm a good wife, been married for 20 years, but I feel a longing and a pulling toward another man, and I don't know why. Been saved for 25 years, and my credit is still jacked up because I've never learned how to manage my money. Why? Because you've been climbing a ladder, ladies and gentlemen, and that ladder is leaning against the wrong wall. We're going to correct that now, okay? You ready to correct it? Let's correct it. I want to introduce you to Mr. A and Mrs. B. I once spoke with Mr. A, who had just purchased an expensive home for his family. He was beginning to make a substantial income, but had not yet recovered from serious debt. It seemed to me that buying a less expensive home and paying off a few overdue loans would have been a more responsible thing to do. This sort of behavior was one of many such irresponsible actions. I asked him why he bought the large home, looking for an explanation for his irresponsibility. He told me that he loved to invite people over and listen to them admire his home. It made him feel good inside. Why did he feel good? What need was Mr. A trying to meet with a fancy house? My experience suggests that although men and women need both kinds of input, for men, the primary route to, well, you know what? Let me not do that yet. Let's talk about Mrs. B. So that's Mr. A. You got Mr. A. He's spending money. He's buying a big house. He's got bills, but he's buying a big house because he really likes for people to admire his home, right? What need was he trying to fulfill? Mrs. B. You guys want to hear about Mrs. B? Or should I just close the book and we just, y'all want to hear? Okay, all right. Not yet. Mrs. B. felt cold toward her husband and was strongly attracted to another man. She was a Christian woman and felt terribly guilty over her feelings. I asked her how the two men differed. Mrs. B really couldn't list any important differences between the two men except one. She was supposed to be committed to her husband, but her relationship with her paramour involved no commitment whatsoever. Keep listening. Now, my experience suggests that although men and women need both kinds of input, for men, the primary route to personal worth is significance. And that's true, guys, because as much as we want our loves we want our wives to love us, the most important thing for a man is that she respects him. Let me say that again. As much as we love for our, and now I'm talking about you young boys need, you know, love me like you need, but as you grow, now that's true, they all hugged up and everything back there. I know, and you know, just that love, it's all good. It really is good. I remember. But as you, God bless you guys to get married. I'm gonna tell you, 5 years in, 10 years in, you're gonna appreciate the love, but you're gonna want her to respect you. You're gonna want her to respect you. That's men. Now, for men, the primary route to personal wealth is significance, and for women, the primary route is security. Women want to be secure. Look at them all hugged up. They want to be secure. It's okay. These are our needs. It's okay. God gave them to us. He made us uniquely different, right? Men and women are different? Men and women are different? Thank God my wife is different from me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Love that woman. Consider the examples at the beginning of this chapter. Mr. A wanted money and recognition that money brings. It is crucial to a proper understanding of him to realize, one, however, that neither money nor recognition were his ultimate goal. They were merely means to an end. His real goal was significance as a basis of feeling self-worth. He needed to regard himself as significant. And let me insist at this point that we must not confuse the sin of pride, I want to run the show, I want my way, with a need of significance. They're different. You can have the need of significance without being prideful, because it's a God-given need. Significance is a normal need, an intrinsic part of man as a personal being, a need that only God himself can fill, and a need that he wants to fill. Mr. A's problem was not that he needed to be significant. We all do. His real problem was rather a wrong belief about what would make him significant. He had fallen for the devilish American myth that money and prestige make you into someone, and he had totally rejected the Lord's teaching that in order to find himself to be truly significant and hence a worthwhile being, you have to lose yourself in total submission to the purpose of God in your life. We know that from Matthew 15. If any man will come after me, he must first deny himself, pick up his cross, and follow me. That's the only way to true significance. It's through Jesus Christ. It's through the denial of self and taking yourself to Jesus Christ. right? Y'all want to hear about Mrs. B's problem? Let's diagnose her problem? Okay. Okay. And then we're going to look at the text in Scripture, and we're going to diagnose this woman's problem in text together, okay? All right. Mrs. B's problem was due, now listen very carefully to this. Some of you may relate to this. Mrs. B's problem was due partly to a threatened significance, but was more basically related to a deep fear of rejection. Here's the explanation. Her need for security was involved. A committed relationship required a maturity she had never developed. Now, I want you lovers back here. You guys, you young lovers, you know what I mean, who think about each other 27 times a day. I want you to listen very carefully to what I'm about to read, okay? Very, very carefully. Yeah, some back there. They're all over the place. This is cool. Okay. A committed relationship required a maturity that she had never developed. As a youngster, she had been pampered to the point where she came to believe that love was a one-way street. All you had to do was sweetly make your needs known. If there was no response, she could cry, sulk, or charmingly smile, and a loving benefactor would appease you by giving in to your every demand. The result of such training was, in Adler's terms, an undeveloped social interest, a felt inability to give. Let me say that again. An undeveloped social interest and a felt inability to give. The first year of her marriage was a frockling good time. Excuse me. Husband and wife were infatuated with each other. They were good looking, healthy, sexually alive, had plenty of money, and no in-law problems. That's funny. No in-law problems. But the realities of two separate human beings living together soon caught up with them. Say that again. But the realities of two separate human beings living together soon caught up with them. It became apparent that the lifelong marriage required a mature commitment beyond what the first year's honeymoon demanded. Mrs. B felt threatened. Can I do it? I've never had to give. Maybe I can't please him. I'm used to being loved without having to do anything. But marital love is a two-way thing, and I have to give myself to it. As we talked, it became clearer that the few times she received disapproval in childhood were instances where she had failed to meet other people's standards of performance. Although as a child, an indulgent love was consistently hers for the asking, she was dimly aware of the possibility of rejection for failing to measure up. Now she was wondering how her husband would react when he saw her as she really was, as she looked beneath the pretty face and the fun personality. She was worried that even if she were to commit herself to the marriage and responsibly try to be a good wife, she might prove inadequate for the job, threatened significant need, and therefore be rejected, threatened security need. A typical human pattern is a tendency to flee to safety when needs are threatened. She knew she could win acceptance in an immature relationship that demanded nothing from her beyond being attractive and fun. A committed relationship in which she had to give of herself as a person and maturely try to satisfy another human being provided an opportunity for her to be rejected. The risk of commitment was overwhelming. She told me that even her adulterous daydreams never included being serious with another man. For her, it was safe to flit about with one uncommitted relationship to another, never facing the awful possibility that she actually could be rejected by someone. Notice that Mrs. B's dilemma becomes understandable when we discuss her threatened need for security. You and I have gone through experiences just like this. You and I, when we were 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 years old, experienced loss. We experienced disappointment. I grew up in a home that was basically taught that if you don't do it right, you get punished. And you get punished severely. So I grew up with a lot of anger, which was my defense mechanism from you if you expected me to be perfect and I wasn't. I didn't understand that at 20 years old. I didn't understand that at 30 years old. I didn't start to understand that till I was 38, 39 years old, and I went to counseling with my wife. And I started to understand that my anger was my defense mechanism, and that defense mechanism was my way of protecting myself from vulnerability. I did not want you to see me naked. I did not want you to see that I couldn't measure up. So I became angry with you and I kept you at bay. But when understanding came and I learned that I could respond differently to those triggers, that I did not have to be perfect, that God wasn't expecting perfection, that was something that my mama and my daddy ignorantly taught me, because that's what they learned. And through a series of counseling and understanding, I learned to forgive my mama. I learned to forgive my father. I learned to forgive myself. I learned that I can still get angry, trust me. But I've learned that I don't have to allow your triggers to take me someplace that I don't need to go, because I can respond differently. Here's the thing. When my mind was renovated, all of a sudden, the anger kind of dissipated. The stuff that I had been fighting with for years just fell off. You know why? Because unlike you and I sometimes, Jesus goes to root causes. He is the master counselor. If you and I, if we were counseling you, if you came to my office and I was counseling you, I'm going to go through a number of steps. How you feeling? How is this affecting you? You see if I can determine what your beliefs are. That's if you tell me the truth. It could take me or my wife 10 sessions, 20 sessions to get to this, 15 sessions, 2 years. Because how many of you know, not all counselees tell their counselors the truth. But Jesus is the mighty counselor. He understands our psyche. He understands what we're going through, which is why 20% of you who are dealing with pornography and all that stuff, God hasn't kicked you from one end of the universe to the next. Have you ever thought about that? That he hasn't beat you up? Because he understands what you're doing is trying to fulfill a need that you don't know how to fulfill. Now, I'm not saying that he's saying it's good, because it's not. And it's destroying you. And it's destroying your relationship, whether you know it or not. Okay? But he's not kicking you to the other end of the universe. It's because through this message today, what he is trying to get you to see is, listen, you can't stop that on your own. I'm telling you, you got some belief systems down on the inside of you that are causing your reaction. And I, because I'm the master counselor, want to get to that so that you can be free. You women that have been married 10, 15 years, same guy, next to him every day, with his snoring and the other things he does in bed. You know? But at work, you see a guy that you don't see in bed. Nice guy, might be your boss. Might be somebody else, handsome, having issues with his marriage. Maybe he's even come to you and said, man, you know, I'm really having some, you know, my wife doesn't get me and all that kind of stuff, which is really just a setup from hell. And you wonder why, Christian woman, you've got feelings toward him. I'm telling you, God hasn't thrown you to the other end of the universe because he knows there's needs inside of you that aren't being met. Well, why can't my husband meet them? Because God did not design human beings to meet other human beings' fulfillment and needs. Christ meets our needs. God meets our needs of significance and security. And as he meets those needs, two whole people come together in marriage, ideally, and live incredible lives. I want to tell you a story from John 4. And all of you counselors and psychoanalysis, we're gonna fix this woman's problem. Okay? One day, Jesus says, I got to go through Samaria, okay? And he's going through Samaria, and he's a little tired. And at the sixth hour, or 12 noon, he stops by Jacob's well. Now, there's a woman that shows up at around 12 noon to fill her pots. One, why would she show up at 12 o'clock when most women show up very early in the morning to get there? I think you're going to find out that she's the kind of woman that really doesn't get along with other women because of her lifestyle, okay? So she's lonely, okay? She's living an isolated life, okay? I'm just throwing these things out at you, okay? So she comes to the, so Jesus is there, and how many of you know that Jesus doesn't do anything by accident? God doesn't do anything by accident. You're not here today by accident. You didn't just happen to show up here today to hear this message by accident. God has you here because he wants you to hear something, because he wants to make you free. So Jesus is showing up at this well by accident, wink, wink. And he says to this woman, he says, get me something to drink. She says, but you don't have nothing to draw with. He said, woman. That's what he said. He said, woman, if you knew who was asking you for this water, you would ask him for water. And this water, if you drank, you would never thirst again. Well, you know, this is Jacob's well, and you know, and so on and so forth, and you're cool. And he said, woman, people that drink the water that you're drawing will thirst again. But the water that I will give, no one would ever thirst again. She says, well, give me this water. Watch the master counsel at work. He says, go get your husband. Wait a minute. Give me this water that I will not thirst again. I'm open. I'm ready to be changed. Go get your husband. I'm not married. He says, you're right. You've had five husbands, and the one that you're with now is not your husband. Okay, therapist, what was her problem? We know that she was isolated. We know that she comes to the well at 12 midnight, at 12 in a day. She's had five husbands, and the one that she's with now is not her husband. What is her problem, ladies and gentlemen? Okay. Could it be that her issue is loneliness, and she's trying to find significance and security through the relationship with men, so much so that she married five of them, and apparently she didn't get what she wanted. And she's on the sixth now, and she just happens to walk into Jesus, and Jesus says, I have something that I will give you that will quench your thirst forever. What was her thirst? Love, security, acceptance. Jesus, being the master counselor, didn't need 10 sessions. When she asked for this water, he said, go get your husband, because he understood that at the root of your issue is your fixation with men. Here's what I want you to know. Jesus is sitting at that same well this morning, and you're the person that's been drawing water. And he says to you, whatever you have been doing to quench your soulish thirst, he says, I can quench your thirst. Here's what he told that woman, Joy. He said, this water that you will drink will bubble up inside of you and become a river of living water. In other words, what I have to give you is internal in your soul, your mind, will, and emotions, your spirit, your heart. I will touch you in places of your soul that your lust, that your seeking money, your hard work, your codependency in relationships, you're treating your husband or your wife well so they can meet your needs, which is not love, that's lust. Lust is the desire to satisfy self at the expense of others. Love is just the opposite. It's a desire to give to you at the expense of myself. So some of us are in relationships where we love one another, but we're practicing it as lust. We don't give to the next person because they deserve it, because they're God's child. We give to you so that you can give back to me, so that I can feel good about myself. That is codependency. That is lust. Oh, Christians, we got some stuff wrong with us. But here's the deal. We are the righteousness of God through Jesus Christ. He died for you and me. He knows our issues. He understands that we are frail. Let me tell you something about your God. Let me tell you something about your God. I want you to look at Isaiah 55. We're almost done. But I've got to let you know who you're dealing with here, how much he loves you. 55. Let's start there. Verses 1 through 3, okay? Come, everyone who thirsts. Come to the waters. He who has no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear that your soul may live, and I will make you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. Look at Isaiah 42. You're going to love this one. You guys are going to love this one. All right, Isaiah 42 and verses 1 through 3. Behold, my servant. Now we're talking about Jesus here. This is Isaiah's prophecy of Jesus Christ. Behold, my servant who I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring justice to the nations. He will not cry aloud or lift up his voice or make it heard in the street. Listen to verse 3. A bruised reed he will not break, and a faintly burning wick he will not quench. This speaks to the gentleness of our Savior. He knows that we're broken inside. And he says to us, woman, if you're broken, I won't break you further. If your light is but dimly shining, I won't flush it out. In fact, I'll fan it so that it grows. Hey, man, I know you can't stop watching pornography. I'm not going to break you. But what I'm going to do is show you that you are significant in me. And that when you need a place to rest, you can lay your head down and rest in me. And in doing so, he removes the need that you have. He removes the reason for you going over there to get a need met that he can meet. Larry, that's good. You've convinced me. I got it. But how does it happen? There are a number of ways. The first thing is you have to acknowledge that you got issues. But God already knows. You didn't hear what I said. You have to acknowledge that you have issues. Larry, I get it. I know I have issues. No, you know you have habits. You don't know where the root causes are. And so the first thing you do is acknowledge to God that I'm lost without you. I don't know where the healing is, but I ask that you fix me because I want to grow. I want to get to a place of spiritual maturity. And here's what God will do. I promise you he will do this. I promise you. It could happen the very next day, but I promise you it won't be too many days before you have prayed that prayer that God will somehow either bring somebody into your life that can you can talk to. You will hear a message, hint, to sensitize you that change is necessary, and so you start running to him. I promise you, God's got godly counselors out there that you can safely discuss your stuff with. Jesus and that counselor will be who Jesus was at Jacob's well, and you are that broken woman or man. I don't know what the conversation was like between Jesus and Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was the tax collector. All I know is that Jesus says, come down out of that tree. I got to come to your house today. We don't know what the conversation was like. All we know is that when Jesus was finished with that conversation with Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus came out of the house and said, if I've stolen anything from anybody, you're a tax collector, man. That's what you do, okay? I will give him back four times. Wait a minute. First of all, Zach, how much money do you have that you can give people four times what you've stolen? The point is, he went into his house a tax collector. He came out a changed man as a result of a conversation that he had with Jesus. The woman that was caught in adultery. All we know is that she came into that conversation about to be stoned, having committed adultery. She walks out of that conversation not being stoned, and Jesus forgiving her for her sins and telling her, go and sin no more. Mary Magdalene, the prostitute, washed Jesus' feet with her hair because her life was changed. Peter, a talkative, boisterous one, life was so changed that he was crucified. When he died, he was martyred and said, I'm not worthy to be crucified like my Lord. Crucify me upside down. Life changed. The Apostle Paul, who killed Christians, met Jesus on the road to Damascus. Never met him before, but he met him this day. Became one of the greatest apostles that ever lived. I know a woman, I'll close with this. I know a woman who, when she was young, she learned that she couldn't take tests, that she, especially math or whatever, whenever she took tests, she got really, really nervous, couldn't pass tests. I understand back in 2011, 2012, she went back to school and not only completed her undergrad in psychology, but went on to complete her master's in clinical mental health counseling. She graduates in a month. Well, you have to take a test for licensing when you complete your master's. This woman who was afraid of taking tests, generally people have to take this test two and three times. Very, very smart people to take it two or three times. She passed it the first time through. Her school called her and said, Marissa Felder, we just want you to know that you are the only student from this school that has ever passed that test. We can change our lives. Our thought patterns, our belief systems don't have to take us to our grave. We stand as children of the Most High God. He has saved us. He has set us free. He has given us new things, new beliefs to believe in. And that is his word, that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. That greater is he that is on the inside of us than he that is in the world. And I don't care if you're 30, 40 or 60, you can still go back to school. You can still change your life. Your life can be better at the end than it was at the beginning. Oh, you need to clap your hands. That woman is going to help a lot of people. And here's the thing. You know, she's been counseling for years. People have always wanted to talk to Marissa. She's just comfortable to talk to. She's loving. She's inviting. Her spirit is soft and warm. Of course God was calling her to this. And together we will pastor and help people, and they will grow. They will grow. Amen? Our Father and our God, it's 15 minutes after 12, Lord. And I said, amen. Lord, these are your people with our issues. You can change us. You can deliver us. You can set us free. We present ourselves before you now as your people, broken with our faults. But we know this. We know this, that as we come to you, you will take our lives. You will not only improve them, you will change us. You will grow us. Allow us, Lord, to accept the reality that change is inevitable and that change is needed. Look into our hearts, look into our lives. Give us that water where we will never thirst again.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.